So good evening, everyone. Once again, I hope you had a wonderful session here. We were seeing that. And I hope this session to match up with that session, we got the best person in Indian in terms of IT, information technology. So we have our Sri Ajay Chaudhary ji on stage. So I'll give a brief introduction of Sri Ajay Chaudhary. So Dr. Ajay Chaudhary is a visionary pioneer who co-founded HCL in 1976 with five others, with a dream of using the microprocessor and changing the world. Today, HCL is valued at an impressive $500 billion. He is chairman of the Mission Governing Board of the National Quantum Mission of India, distinguished fellow at Niti Aayog, fellow at Indian National Academy of Engineers. He has been nominated as MITI as a member to the Advisory Board of India Semiconductor Mission. In recognition of his efforts to build the IT and electronics industry in India, in 2011, he was conferred the prestigious Padma Bhushan, the third highest civilian honor in India by the Honorable President of India, regarded as the father of Indian hardware. Ajay sir has been a relentless advocate of the self-sufficiency in electronics. As an institutional builder, Dr. Ajay Chaudhary has played a crucial role in shaping centers of learning and creating spaces for intellectual growth and development. These include IIT Hyderabad, IIIT Naya Raipur, which he as chairman helped set up and develop into reputable institutions that they are today. Since 2011, Ajay sir has been deeply involved in nurturing and mentoring and investing in startups and has personally invested in more than 50 of them. We at SIIC IIT Kanpur are proud to say that he is the board member of the incubator and he regularly mentors the startups for their growth. With this brief introduction, I request everyone to join me in welcoming Dr. Ajay Chaudhary onto the dais with a big round of applause. I request Mr. Piyush Mishra, COO of SIIC IIT Kanpur, to welcome with a bouquet of flowers. Now I welcome Ajay sir to the podium to speak, to give his address. Thank you.
I'm happy to be back in Kanpur after about 10 odd years. I was here 10 years ago giving a similar lecture. Well, this time I want to talk about what has happened, with how I started, what I did, and then, of course, I do want to tell you about why I wrote this book called Just Aspire. And definitely, my whole objective would be to get you to understand where we are today in the country, where I believe we should be going. What is the future of technology, and where is especially information technology going, and as a country, how do we get to that target of what is called Viksit Bharat by 2047? It's not going to happen on its own. a lot of us have to play a role in making all of that happen. And we need to become a developed country. Otherwise, we will get caught up in being a middle-income country and continue to do so. Many countries like Thailand, etc., have much higher income per person, but they have got still caught up in this whole middle-income trap. So we need to see how, as all of us Indians, we can take us away from being this underdeveloped or developing country to a developed country. Now, what I believe will make this happen is just one word: aspiration. And that's why I wrote this book, which is called Just Aspire. And I felt that if all of us have the aspiration to do something different, to do something that we really want to do, then as a person, as a company, as a state, as a country, we can all succeed. So aspiration is at the heart of really being successful. Many, many years ago, I had a guru, Dr. C.K. Prahlad, very famous strategy professor in Michigan. And he used to always say, A is greater than R. A stands for aspiration. R stands for resources. And what does that really mean? It really means that if you have the aspiration, resources will happen. So I meet a lot of startups. Somebody says, I don't have the money. Somebody says, I don't have the environment. Somebody says, I don't have the people. All of that happens if you actually have the aspiration to make it happen. Now, I will demonstrate to you all of this through my own story. My own story starts in a little town called Jabalpur. I came from a middle-income family. My father was in the IAS. My mother was a homemaker. And it was a small town environment. I did my schooling there. Initially, my father used to be in the IAS, so we moved from city A to B to C to D. All over the time, we were keeping moving from one city to the other. And therefore, my education initially was all in Hindi. There was no question of English medium at that, some of those cities that we were in. And then I land up in this city called Jabalpur, where my father decided to build a home and retire after his many IAS positions. And when I reached Jabalpur, my father said that, look, if you want to succeed, you have to get into English medium. So I had a 3-month crash course in learning English, and I joined an English school called Christ Church. And then I did my engineering from there. But if you look at how you get influenced as a person, all influences happen to you around, from people around you. So my father was an administrator, very, very strict, great stickler for being absolutely straight, no corruption, no nothing. And he was also a poet. So in a manner, he influenced me very early to understand culture. I understood music, I understood poetry, and that influenced me. And then my sisters were all very, very solid in academics. And my brother was in marketing. He was a big supporter of being a marketing person. And therefore, in a manner, he influenced me when I was doing my electronics and telecom engineering. And during that period, he would give me a whole bunch of books to read on marketing. So I started my life reading Kotler very early days. And so many, many things I learned during that period. But this influence of marketing and sales remained in me. So when I decided that I would look at what I should be doing after engineering, marketing was pretty much top of mind. And that happens to all of us. It depends on how you get influenced in your early days. But one thing I would definitely like to mention, that from the earliest days, I had a lot of multiple interests. And these multiple interests really helped me in life. And this is why I tell everyone who does engineering or anything else they do, do not be just a specialist in what you are doing. And this is exactly what I did when I started out IIT Hyderabad. I was the founder, chairperson of that institution. And the first thing I told the director is that I do not want nerds coming out of this institute. I want complete people coming out of this institute. So from day one, we created a model of students being able to choose subjects beyond engineering. And I call it a T. You know, the length of the tree is all about your own subject. So you want to be the Dada in electronics, you be a Dada in electronics. But the top portion of the T is where you learn other areas that you should be in. And that actually makes you somebody with a range of interests. And I think range of interests in life are very critical. Many years ago, many people have written books and have talked about specialization and micro-specialization. I don't believe in that. I believe that, yes, you should know one subject brilliantly, but in addition, you should be a complete person by learning other things. So when I was in early days of my college, I was deeply interested in space. So those days, there was nothing called internet. There was nothing called TV. So all you had was a radio and newspapers. But you had to write letters to get whatever you wanted to do. So early days of my college, I started being very interested in space, and I used to write letters to NASA and request them to send me pictures of the new vehicles that they were creating and technologies that they were creating. And so my room was full of space pictures in my house. And then, of course, I was very interested in music, and I used to sing in school as well as college. And then, in addition to that, I had a whole bunch of pen friends all over the world. These days, it's so much easier. You, through Facebook, etc., you make friends all over the world. But those days, it was not possible. So I sort of had a pseudo, stuff that I was doing through writing letters. And then, of course, I was a very ardent shortwave listener. And, you know, those days, the only way you could hear radio was on medium wave. There was nothing called FM. Medium wave, which was very close to where you stayed. And shortwave, you actually connected you to the rest of the world. So shortwave listeners were people like us who would actually sit with their radio and start to tune and find the right frequency for 30, 40 stations all over the world. And that's how you sort of connected with the rest of the world. Or rest of the world about, you know, news, article, stuff on different areas, or music. So that's how I developed my range of thinking. And I think that's dramatically helped me to understand people much better. Because it's not about managing only. It's not about engineers manning engineers. Tomorrow you'll be an engineer. Day after tomorrow you will be a general manager. Day after that, you'll be an owner or managing director or a CEO of your company. At that stage, you have to manage people with different interests. And if you actually learn these interests, you have multiple interests, it's much easier for you to manage. Why is it that Indians all over the world, CEOs, why are Indians preferred over others all over the world? Reason for it is that From day one, we are multicultural. You are managing a Tamilian, you're managing an Andhra person, you're managing a Keralite, you're managing somebody from MP, UP, you're managing multiple languages, multiple cultures, multiple religions. This range is very valuable for us when we go abroad to manage global companies. And that's why you see so many Indian CEOs being successful globally. So this range is something that I constantly tell people that you must look at creating. The other thing that I want to mention, I'll just pick up some water. So I talk about all of this in my book called Just Aspire. Now, when I finished my engineering, one thing was very clear in my mind that yes, I have become an engineer, but I didn't want to do just engineering work. So in my mind, I wanted to be in sales and marketing. And therefore, those days were very early days of opening of India. India was, you know, all that you had those days was government jobs and a few private sector jobs. So most of my class fellows went either abroad or they sort of picked up government jobs. And since I came from a telecommunication electronics background, everybody went and joined Department of Telecom. So very few jobs were around. But then I said, okay, I'm not going to do what others are doing. I'm going to do something different. And I'm going to apply only for sales and marketing jobs. It took me 6 months. For 6 months, there was nothing. And I kept waiting. The jobs were so rare. And it just so happens that in about 10 days period, I got 3 letters asking me for an interview. And all the 3 interviews were in Delhi. And all were for sales and marketing jobs. So I was thrilled. I said, okay, that's a great opportunity for me to go and get interviewed and let's see what happens to getting a job. And so I go to Delhi, I stay with my sister, and I'd been to Delhi many, many times before. So stayed there for about 10 days, appeared for all 3 interviews. And about 15 days later, I had all the 3 jobs. Now comes the time to decide which job to pick. Well, that's what life is all about. You sometimes become lucky. I picked up the right job. If I hadn't picked up the right that particular job, I would never have created HCL. So it's one of those things that happened to you in life. You do the right thing at a particular time based on how you are thinking. And I said, look, I am in electronics. I've done electronics. I'll join DCM Data Products, which was an electronics company, which had just been started a few years ago. So I said, great idea. Let me go and join them. And I started out as a sales trainee there with a princely salary of 600 rupees. So that's how you start in life. Okay. And so there I was with the 600 rupee salary. I got posted to Bombay. And 3 of us landed up in Bombay to start the DCM office there. And this office was located in the mezzanine floor of a DCM cloth shop. So here we were trying to sell electronics and we were part of a cloth shop at mezzanine floor. And that's all that DCM was willing to give us. So we stayed there and we created life out there. But then of course, we didn't have a home. So I went to my HR manager in Delhi and I said, we don't have a house to stay. How are we going to manage in Bombay with 600 rupees? So they said, I will bring up the manager of the textile shop and let's see what he can do for you. So the manager was very kind and he gave us his own flat, which was in a place called Ghatkopar in Bombay. So these 2 of us land up in Ghatkopar in Bombay into this house and it was in shambles. All the window panes were broken. Birds were all over the place, and you can imagine what the birds do to your home. So the bird shit was all over the place. And that's where we stayed for the first few months till we found our own place. So, you know, but all of this taught something to me, and that is that whatever you have, whatever you get, you need to make the best of it. And having chosen that particular job, it was the right decision, because from there, six of us one day decided to leave and start HCL. And at that stage, there was nothing called venture capitalists. There was nothing called angels. There was no funding available for startups. There was nothing called a, there was not a word anybody knew, something that everybody could call a startup. There was nothing called startups. So we were a little company that took off, and six of us said that, look, the microprocessor is making its appearance. Let's go and take the microprocessor and change the world. And that's how we decided to start. When we went deeper, and during that particular period, all of us said, hey, how much money do you have? How much money do you have? How much money do you have? And we all put together 1.86 lakhs. With 1.86 lakhs, we started HCL. And today, HCL is a $6 billion company. So it's all about A is greater than R. It's not necessary that you have everything. And the challenge at that time was that if you wanted to start a computer company, you needed a license. And so life took a turn. We started a little marketing company to gather some cash flow. And we went to a couple of calculator companies and said, hey, you guys don't know how to market calculators. We learned all that in DCM. We created the calculator business. We created the computer business. We know how to do it. So we went to a couple of companies. We started marketing, and we went all over the country marketing products. We created some cash, because 1.86 lakhs was not good enough to start a computer company. But we needed a license to manufacture those days. And those days, no technology imports were allowed. So whatever product you made, you had to make it ground up. So what do? One day, during dinner with somebody, we were told that UP government had a license for computers. So we went to UP Electronics Corporation, met the chairperson, and told him that, look, we are a bunch of young engineers. We know how to make computers. We know how to market them, because this is what we've been doing in DCM. And we would like to start a computer company, but we don't have a license. Can we partner with you? After a few months of discussion, the UP government agreed. So HCL was born in UP. HCL was born from Lucknow in a manner where UP Electronics Corporation existed. Okay, and so we started by getting that license, and then we decided that, look, if we want to be successful, we need to have the best people working for us. So for that, you need money. But good news was that as we had formed a joint sector undertaking with UP, we decided to name our company differently. And we said we'll call ourselves Hindustan Computers Limited. Big, it was a major decision that we took. It's the most important decision that we took, to name our company Hindustan. Those days, if you wanted to call yourself Hindustan, you had to be a big company, or you had to be a government company. But we went to registrar of companies and told them, hey, we are a joint sector company. We are also partially government. So why can't we get this Hindustan name? And we managed to get it. To me, that was a major, brilliant decision that we took, because with that name, we could walk into any customer premises and get respect. We were no longer thought of as a small startup company. Everybody, when they read Hindustan Computers Limited on the card, they assumed that we were a big company. And so our life started as Hindustan Computers Limited, with a little shed in Noida. And we decided to make our first computer for scientific and engineering applications. And it was a desktop computer using 4-bit technology. All right. We today have quad core and this and that in phones. And here we were starting with a 4-bit technology on a desktop. But that's how we started. And we started working on the design of this product. As we were designing the product, we suddenly realized that if we needed to stay alive, we needed to do business. And just by designing the computer and waiting for the computer to be ready, it wasn't just good enough. So we took this bold decision. We said, let's go and hire 10, 12 people from Institute of Management. And let's bring them in. Let's create a great institution with great people to start with. So we decided to do that. And we went to Institute of Management, Calcutta, to hire people. And as we had to, those days, you had to give a presentation to students. And if you gave a presentation to students, and if they liked what they heard, they would join you. They didn't like what they heard, they won't join you. So we finished up our presentation, and we told the students, this is what we want to do. And we said, we'll give you the highest salary in the country. We don't take that kind of salary, we will give it to you. So, and you can you imagine what that salary was? Anybody? Anybody? Take a guess. Sorry? 2,000 rupees. 2,000 rupees per month was the highest salary in the country those days. I'm talking of 1976. So they said, okay, great, you're giving us the highest salary in the country. But you know, you're just starting out. How do we believe that you will be successful? How do we join a company like that? So we said, look, we are not offering you a job. What we are offering you is adventure. If you want an adventure, join HCL. If you want a job, go to Microsoft. So that's the aggressive stance that we took, and it really worked. All 10 of them joined. And that creating great people is what creates a company. And so having done that, the next step was that how do we go about creating business without a product? Our product was just getting ready. It was still, those days there was no concept of simulations. So you could not actually make a computer using simulations. You had to actually go ground up and make a breadboard model on a table. So we had a long table like that, and the PCBs were spread all over the place, wires all over the place, and that was the R&D that was going on to create our first product. So what do? We just decided that we will have to do something completely different and bold, and what I would call audacious. And that's what HCL stands for, audaciousness. And when I tell you my story, you'll see it right through the way we have created this company. So we said, okay, we don't have a product. Let's create a beautiful brochure. So we spent a lot of effort and time creating that lovely looking brochure of what the product will be. And that brochure we took, and we trained all our salespeople and said, go sell the product. So they said, hey, there's no product. We can't even give demonstrations. How do we actually get the business? So no, that's the way you have to do it. Go talk to engineers, scientists in labs, go talk to IIT professors and tell them, we are a bunch of young engineers. We're just starting out. We need your support. So here we go to, we started out, my colleague Arjun, he's one of our co-founders. He said, okay, I'll go get the first order. Everybody felt great. If we can get one order from one institute, we can replicate it. So he went off to his alma mater, IIT Kharagpur, And he went and met all the profs and he said, we're just starting out. We need your support and we need you to be our first customer. We will be very proud if you're our first customer. Look at the amount of selling that's going on. You know, no product, no nothing. You're still trying to sell through a brochure. He went and got the first order. And then we went to many IITs and every IIT gave us orders. IIT Kanpur, IIT Madras, IIT Delhi. We got orders from everywhere. Product was still getting ready. And then, but every one of the IITs said, guys, if you do not deliver by 31st March next year, our funds will expire. And don't let us down. So we feverishly worked on creating the product. And I still remember I had got orders for 6 machines from IIT Madras. I was posted to Madras. And on 29th of March, the 6 machines arrived in Madras airport. I took my beat up old Fiat, drove to the airport, picked up the product, went and personally delivered to the profs and met my commitment. If we had not done that, there would be no HCL. So, you know, this is really what how companies are formed. You need to be able to take risks, and you need to be able to have great sales capability. I pay a lot of attention to sales capability. Every CEO of every startup, when I meet them, I said, do you believe you're a good salesman or not? If you are not a good salesman, I'm sorry, you're not going to succeed. So this is something that I tell every startup. Spend time on learning how to sell. Salesmanship is not, you're not born a salesperson. I was an inward-looking introvert. But I learned how to sell. And because I was taught how to sell. And that's really what you have to do to be successful in life. If you want to be a great CEO, whether you're a startup or a large company, the best salesman is the CEO. If you're not a salesman, you cannot succeed. Okay? So that's really how we created HCL. And having done that, we didn't look back. And you'll be surprised that we had competition from day one. We had some public sector companies like ECIL. We had large companies like DCM. We had large companies like Sarabhai. We had large companies from Tata. Tata's had a company called Nelco. All of them were making computers. And so we were born with competition. And still succeeded. We were just a little startup. In 10 years of starting HCL, we became the number one computer company of India. That really tells you what HCL is all about. We created a company which became the number one in the country in 10 years. All out of UP. Okay, so UP is actually, in a manner, our home as far as HCL is concerned. We have the largest number of employees in UP. We are the largest employer of UP even today. Okay, so that's how we created HCL. So then what happens to me? I'm in Madras. I have a little child of a few months. And my co-founder Shiv Nader comes to Madras and sits down and says, Ajay, I would like you to go to Singapore. We were just 3 years old as a company, barely 3 crores. And he said, I have decided that we should set shop in Singapore. Let's go and manufacture our computers in Singapore. So here we are. You may have heard of so many software companies going abroad and setting up offices. How many companies have you heard of that go and make and sell hardware from India abroad? HCL is the only one that did it. So we went to Singapore and we started and we had no money. RBI would not allow you to take too much money. Those days, all of us, when we went abroad, used to get $5 to go abroad. That's all we could take. Even the company was not allowed to move money too much. So with great difficulty, we managed to get a loan we managed to get some money and we got started in Singapore. And the target was that in the first 6 months, we'll sell $1 million worth of hardware. And we did that. So that's how we started out at, in the global markets, very early days. And then, of course, we started to expand in the region. And we made a big bid for you from United Nations in China. And we got our first deal where 23 global companies were participating. And we got that deal. And so after getting our first United Nations deal in China, we started to go to China more often and got a lot of business in China those days. China was pretty underdeveloped then. We are talking about the 80s. So I'll tell you some of my interesting experiences of China. And one of them was the fact that if you went to China to get a deal or an order, you walked in there, two of us would go in there, one guy from Singapore, one me, two of us. And these 12 guys are sitting across the table. Okay. And these 12 guys are negotiating with these two guys. So first of all, you're totally outnumbered. Okay. And then there is one guy sitting here on the side whom we don't know who he is, but he's sitting on the side and he says nothing. So we are just sitting there and then we are negotiating and we discuss, we present our technology, this, that, all discussion happens for 2 hours. And at the end of 2 hours, one guy from the team across just gets up and goes to the board and said, puts up a number and he said, that's the price we want. Now that price was 60% of the price we had quoted. So we said, we're so sorry, we just can't match what you want. There's no way we can match this price. So they all got up and went away. And that was around 1 o'clock in the afternoon. And we were in a hotel, we were staying there till about 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, we didn't know what was happening. Then suddenly around 8:30, 9 o'clock, we get a call to say, come tomorrow morning at 11 o'clock. So we said, okay, let's go tomorrow morning at 11 o'clock. So again, we start discussing. And again, in about an hour, he got up and put another number, which was higher than the earlier number that he had put. So this happens for 2 days. And the third day, the same thing happens. Fourth day, we have to leave China because we do not have a hotel booking. And we do not have an air ticket out of China. Those days, to get a ticket or a hotel was impossible in China. These guys knew that. So for their negotiation strategy, they kept us till day four. And till 3 hours before our flight, they knew that if they negotiate, they'll get what they want. So that's how Chinese negotiate. So they were damn smart. They knew from day one, we were going to be there for 4 days. Next trip, we were smarter than them. Indians can be damn smart. So next time, what we did was that we booked ourselves into two separate hotels. We booked ourselves two separate flights. They thought we were finishing on day four, but actually we had 3 more days left. So, you know, somehow you learn from your experience and you actually do something smarter. My second experience of China, of course, you'll read about it in my book, How I Survived Eating Chinese Food. You know, the only way I survived eating Chinese food was by having pan masala next to me. Okay. So after every dinner, I would take dollops of pan masala to change the taste, you know, because whatever you were eating, you didn't know what you were eating. Okay. Anything that moves, they eat. So here we are. One day I had to, they took me to see the Great Wall and I said, they said, let's have lunch. So we had lunch and we finished the lunch. And then I said, what did we eat just now? He said, you ate mule meat. I wanted to actually throw up, but anyway, lasted. So anyway, that's what China is all about. So one particular day, I must tell you something more interesting happened to me in China. We were in my room and the customer said, we want to come to your room and have a discussion. So four of them arrived in my room. two of us, this side, four of them, that side. And we were having a good discussion on technology and this and that. Of course, by that time, one thing I had done was to learn about 20 technical words in Chinese. So I knew what relational database was called in Mandarin. So I picked up all these words. So when they were chatting with me, I used to pick up what they were trying to say. At least I could guess what they were trying to say. So anyway, suddenly one guy got up and went away. And then he came back. Then another person got up, went away, came back. Third person got up, went away, came back. Fourth person got up, went away, came back. When we finished the meeting, I asked, they went away. And then I asked my colleague, hey, what the hell were they doing going away in between? He said, they were going to use your shower. They were going to have a bath in your room. Because those days, there only used to be communal baths in China. Nobody had a bathroom at home. So obviously, I immediately rang up the reception and said, change my room. I didn't want to use the same towels they had used or the same, you know, soap they had used. So that's really what China was those days. And then I went back to China during the Beijing Olympics. And it was a completely different China. I mean, massively built up, brilliant technology being used everywhere. Buildings were fantastic. Hotels were fantastic. When I used to go there, there used to be one hotel called Freedom, and that's it. Nothing else. So that's how everything had changed in China. Now, after this experience of mine in China, I came back to India. And because the Indian business was growing like crazy. As I said, we had already become number one in the country. And the business was in very good shape. And the growth was so phenomenal that Shiv Nader said, everybody has to come back. No need to stay outside the country because India is becoming big. That's how we came back. And I sort of created the whole computer business for HCL and then created the CAD/CAM business for HCL. And then one day, we decided to get into mobile telephony. So when we wanted to get into mobile telephony, we applied for a license. Those days when Airtel and all came into the country, they all applied for licenses. So we also applied for a license. And the proposal for applying a license was so huge, it actually filled up two trucks. Two big trucks went to deliver the proposal to the government. And once we finished up, We got a license in Chennai, and we had done the agreement with Singapore Telecom to actually participate in creating telephony in India, and we got that license. And then suddenly Singapore Telecom backed out, and they said they've got too much business happening in China, so they don't want to participate in India, and we were left holding that license doing nothing. So having not got the license in telecom, we decided, let's do something different. And this is what startups, in startup language, is called pivot. You need to pivot from where you are to something close to what you were doing, something adjacent. So we said, what's the adjacency to a telecom service provision? We were a hardware company. We said, okay, let's do telephones. So we went to Motorola and said, we want to market your phones in India. We went to Nokia and said, we will manufacture your pagers in India. We started manufacturing pagers in India for Nokia. And then we went into marketing their phones in India. And we created a complete ecosystem to sell phones as if we were selling soap. We actually copied the whole Hindustan lever strategy of how soaps are sold. And we said, we need to change the way phones are sold. Those days, phones used to be sold globally by telecom companies. We told Nokia, that's not going to work in India. If we want to be dependent on the growth of the business, depending on telecom companies was not good enough. Again, a very audacious move. So we said, we'll set up a distribution company. We set up a distribution company. We went and took all the redistributors of Godrej and Dabur and Levers, and converted them to being phone distributors. And we said we will send phones your way if soap is sold. In 6 years, we created an 8,000 crore business. Right. So it's all about thinking out of the box, thinking differently, picking up a opportunity when you can see it. And in my book, I talk about it as noise to signal. In electrical engineering, if you hear a noise, you know it's going to be a signal. So that's what we did in HCL. We would always be able to pick up ideas and strategies at the noise level. By the time it was a signal, everybody could hear it. But when it was a noise, only a few people can hear it. So we picked it up at the noise level and we created this business. So one of the things that I also learned in my life was that how to learn from others, how to learn from tall people, as I call them. So I met a lot of people in my life. I went to Bill Gates' home. I did a whole bunch of stuff, meeting all the top and other places. And I always used to say, this is something that I learned from somebody, used to say that if you stand on the shoulders of tall men, you can see far. And that really taught me something. So I started to meet a lot of these people. I must have met Bill Gates some 15, 20 times. I went to his home also, understood how he used technology in his home. And you know, in his home, he had a digital license to all the world-class paintings. So if you actually walked around in his whole home, every room had a digital painting. And the digital painting used to keep changing as you went around in his home. So, you know, a techno guy will create a home which is totally different. He brought actually sand from a sea and put it in front of his home. So actually you came by boat to his home and you suddenly were on sand. One person that I sort of met at Bill Gates' home as we were traveling on the boat, there was one person standing in one corner, and I was thinking, why is this chap standing there all alone? So I walked up to him and said, hello, I'm Ajay. So he says, I'm Ray. So then I started talking, and then I understood he was Ray Kurzweil. Ray Kurzweil, who was one of the pioneers of artificial intelligence. So as I started chatting with him, I had read his books. And I had read this book, which was called Singularity is Near. And as I told you earlier, I have great interest in all kinds of things. So I was very interested in futurology. So I was following Ray Kurzweil for many years. And Ray kept predicting all kinds of things. So as I was chatting with him, I told him, I said, I've read your book and I'm very happy to meet you, because, you know, it was my dream to meet a person like this. And so we had a very nice chat. And then he told me that he is working on his next book. And so I said, what is that new book? He says, my next book is going to be called How to Live Forever. How to Live Forever. So I said, what's it all about? I mean, what's it got to do with artificial intelligence? So he said, no. I have been working with a friend of mine who's an MD, and we have now come up with this whole thinking that the body is a chemical factory. And this chemical factory, if you create a balance of all the chemicals in the factory, you will not age. I was totally surprised. He said, I'll give you a pre-release copy of the book. You read it. And so what I understood from that, and he was actually carrying 60 pills in his pocket. Every day he used to have 60 pills, and he would change his blood every weekend. And he told me that I am 60 and my body parts are 40, 45. So Ray Kurzweil is that kind of a person who would do all kinds of things beyond artificial intelligence. And that again teaches me and teaches you that it's not just that one subject that you should go after. And so Ray Kurzweil predicted at that time that singularity will happen. Singularity will happen somewhere in 2045. What singularity? Fundamentally, if you look at the whole concept that computers will overtake the human brain, and that's when singularity will happen. So he was talking about singularity happening in the 1999-2000 time frame. And this strategy that he talked about, he said, this will definitely happen. And I've been following him since then. Any of you, please go to YouTube and you'll find a whole bunch of lectures that he's given. And he had two basic concepts that he always talked about. One was singularity, and the other was exponential growth. He always said, if you want to get somewhere, you need to be doing it exponentially. So he gives you an example. If you look at, you go to Google and you ask for what's been the change in computational power from 1939 to 2023. If you look at the growth of computational power from 1939 to 2023, you will find it grew exponentially. That means it doubled every 14 years. So it's a completely straight line. It's quite amazing. Go and see it. It's got nothing to do with war or peace or any of these things. It just kept happening. So it's all about exponential growth. And if exponential growth is what is life all about, he then started a university in California, which is called the Singularity University. And this Singularity University started with another futurologist who's called Diamandis. Diamandis and Ray Kurzweil started this university, and it teaches you everything about exponential growth. Now, if India has to become a Viksit Bharat in 2047, can we keep going on our linear path? Not possible. If we continue on our linear path, we'll never get there. We will remain an underdeveloped country. We will remain a middle income country. So as a country, we also need to think that we need to grow exponentially. So I'll tell you a story around that. About 6 months ago, seven of us in the tech business and others, we all got together and we said, what should India do in the next 25 years? What should India look like 2047? How can we be a developed country? So we decided that the only way India can be a developed country if we move from services to products. Our whole economy today is based on services. But services are under threat. If you look at software services, what is threatening software services today? AI. Gen AI is actually going to impact software services. As a matter of fact, AI is going to impact every service that you can think of. Look at what's happened to, we were dadas in garments. The whole business moved to Bangladesh because Bangladesh was cheaper than us. BPO, we were very big in BPO services. Philippines took over and took it away from us. We are the largest diamond cutting industry in the world. but totally services based. Where is the value lying? The value is lying in people who make the diamond cutting machines in China. So we started to think that if we want to be a developed country, we need to move from being a services economy to be a product nation in everything that we do. And so we are putting together a paper for the government. We've been talking to the government for a while, telling them how we can become a product nation. And I think that's very critical, because as all of you start to look at what startups you are creating, what businesses that you want to be in, what companies you want to be part of, watch out. The days of services are limited. The next 15, 20 years will convert to being a product country. We have to do that. And therefore, as engineers, you have all the capability of creating products. So I remember during COVID, four kids from IIT Kanpur worked with us. Six, we were two of us in the beginning, and then it became 30 of us. And during COVID period, we created a ventilator in 90 days. And that was all about creating a product. But one thing I discovered after the product was made is that the product had not taken the basics of making a product. So I think what needs to be done is that the education system has to now start to look at how do we create engineers who make things. And I think this whole concept of, you know, playing around with things and having these little labs where you actually start to work with your own hand is very critical. We need to start to create more and more products out of this country, whether they are in electronics, whether they're in mechanical. See, you see today, the world has changed. There's so many startups today in space. In space alone, there are 500 startups. Okay, in medtech, there are close to 400 to 500 startups. In two-wheeler EVs, we are world leader in two-wheeler EVs already. And it's all due to startups. Drones. One of the big companies in drones has got for a listing. All this is happening in the startup ecosystem. The India has to become the startup capital of the world. And we need to become the product capital of the world. What position that China took in the last 15, 20 years to be successful, we need to get there. And why can we get there? Because there is a great opportunity to get there. Today, nobody in the world trusts China. India has phenomenal trust. India's engineering capability is very well known. India's scientific capability is very well known. Do you know, out of the 250 billion figure that NASSCOM talks about for software exports, inside that is sitting a figure of $39 billion. This $39 billion is called engineering and R&D exports. Who does this engineering and R&D exports? Few companies like HCL and some others, 8 or 10 Indian companies, maybe 20. Rest is all done by global companies sitting in India. There are 160 global companies in India who design products in India. The world's majority of the world's chips are designed in India. But we don't have the IP for those products. We don't get the value for those products. We are fundamentally people sitting and doing work for global companies. So that 39 billion is not the real figure. 39 billion, as I call it, is the transfer price of the global companies. The real value of India's engineering and R&D exports is 100 billion. So if this 100 billion capability is sitting in India, why can't we be the product nation in the world? Because we have all the capability. So suddenly a lot of engineers in these GCCs in Bangalore are coming out and starting their own startups. Because they have now understood that if they can create global companies out of India, they can be hugely successful. So that's really what I want to leave all of you with, that There is a great opportunity. You're sitting at the right place at the right time. And India is where the opportunity is. As a matter of fact, the last chapter of my book is all about how India should be a product nation. And I strongly believe that creating India as a product country is essential if we want to be successful as a country. This country has the best engineering and R&D brains. We have the numbers. We have the capability. We have domestic huge market, which a Vietnam or a Cambodia or an Indonesia or a Singapore doesn't have. China is the only country that has that kind of market. So your market opportunity is huge. You know, a friend of mine wrote a book many years ago. It was called the 86% opportunity. And what did that 86% stand for? 86% of the world's population sits in India, China, and Africa. So if you design a product for 86% of the world sitting in India, you'll be more successful rather than the Europeans and the Americans who actually design and make products for 14% of the world. And that's why these global companies have all come to India, because they've understood that if they sit in India, they can design for the world. So it's a very interesting world that faces you today. The opportunity size for Indian engineers, Indian startups, Indian scientists is phenomenal. Currently, I am the chairman of the Quantum Mission. When I was trying to figure out how many startups are there in quantum, so I made a list and it came to just 30-40 startups. We need to have 400-500 startups for us to get somewhere in quantum. Quantum is going to be the next level of technology in computing. Okay, and quantum and AI combined will really be mind-blowing. So I think very critically, I would like to see at least 30, 40, 50 quantum startups starting up in IIT Kanpur, because that quantum is going to be the next piece that is happening. China has put $35 billion behind quantum. $35 billion. They already have quantum communication 2,000 kilometers physically. India has quantum communication 200 meters, 300 meters. I'm talking to a couple of startups and they're saying we can get you to 2,000 kilometers. So I know all these things are happening. Some very interesting technologies are happening. Lots and lots of bets are there for us to take. We can do drones, we can do space, we can do semiconductors, we can design chips, we can be in quantum. The opportunity size for today's children is enormous. I wish I was younger. Thank you. Any questions? I'll be very happy to answer any questions that you have.
Sir, I understand your focus on marketing. I have spent a lot of time in TCS, and I think TCS is not that much focused on marketing as compared to delivery. So I would like to understand from your experience the two models, the delivery versus sales focus for an organization, and how do you see it happening in the long term? Because I have seen it many times, a company like TCS, with their delivery capability, they lose out because the sales focus is not there. But at the end of the day, they are doing equally well.
Well, you can't take anything away from TCS. They are the country's largest software company. And the reason why they're the country's largest software company is they have many, many customers already, number one. Number two, they have excellent delivery capability. People believe in what they deliver. So there is a lot of trust that that brand has today. So I think that's why they've been successful. When HCL started, we were in the hardware business. And later on, we decided that we also need to be in software, but we were very, very late. And by the time we got into software, we were very small. We were in millions while they were in billions. So we said the only way we can be successful is if we start to do some acquisitions. So we acquired some 12 to 14 companies and we started to grow. And we looked at our strength, and the first strength that we went after is our engineering and R&D design capability, which came out of hardware. So we created a very large ER&D capability out of India, and we are still the largest engineering and research company in India. But then later on, we also created new areas like infrastructure management. Again, coming from the hardware business, we knew how to manage infrastructure globally. And that's how we innovated and created the infrastructure business. You'll be surprised that I'll tell you a story, and this is an audacious story all over again. I was sitting with my co-founder, Shiv Nadar, in Beijing Olympics that I was talking to you guys about. And suddenly he gets a call. And in that call, somebody tells him that, look, the company that we were trying to buy, Infosys has already bought it. And it was an 800 million deal in UK. And Infosys announced in the newspapers that they'd bought it. So what do we do? I mean, we lost that opportunity. So after a while, he says, watch this space. Next day, when we were sitting around in the evening, he gets a call. And then he tells me, we outbid Infosys and we bought that company. That's HCL. That's what selling is all about. That's why you have to be audacious. So that's why the DNA of HCL is very different from TCS. TCS is a great company, but HCL's DNA is all about great salesmanship. And if you see my book, you'll find one full chapter on salesmanship, because I believe that that's really what a startup needs.
Good afternoon, Mr. Choudhary. Maninder here, if you can see me. Part of the team that founded infrastructure in HCL, so very pleased to listen to you again. One question, and I think you very aptly, and now I've been working with ITK, SIC, been mentoring a few people here. And you greatly said, besides HCL's engineering legacy, there was this great ability to sell, and you were probably the fountainhead for that effort. We are seeing a great number of startups in many areas. The volume simply on the supply side, the story is great. It's coming up in newspapers. As a country, how do we solve the demand side of the problem? And the reason I ask is I've now spoken to a lot of people. Our consumption of what is coming out of startups, maybe it's at an inflection point. We don't see it. Our ability to consume and buy innovative companies and experiment, both in private and government, seems to be a little bit of a question mark right now. When you go to Western countries, one of the things you very clearly see is they're very, very fast in adopting a new product, taking a, I mean, we've all worked in global markets, so we've seen that. How's that going to happen in India, and what's the ecosystem that is required? Because right now the government is putting a great deal of effort on supply side. All the incubators, the MIT initiative, Startup India. How do we really solve the demand side of the problem so that these companies become successful? Obviously, the success ratio is a minuscule percent. We know that in startups, but is that something where there is a learning and where there we need to do something? And especially think tanks have to do something.
You have hit the nail on the head. It is the biggest requirement for startups in this country. How do they get their first business? How do they get their second business? How do they get their 100th business? How their innovation is accepted and recognized by the government? Because anywhere in the world, government is the largest buyer. So how did America succeed? America succeeded because they had a terrific defense organization called DARPA. DARPA decided from day one, they are not going to do anything on their own. They are going to be just project managers. So all they have is about 200 project managers who manage projects, who decide which technology needs to be created for the country. And they give out this, they give out funds to startups and companies. Go create this product. If you create this product, I will give you business and I'll continue to give you business. And that's how the whole military complex, the Boeings and all these companies that have got created, the McDonald's, all, you know, McDonnell Douglas, all these companies got created out of DARPA. DARPA did something more interesting. Not only did they create business, they created companies, they also created technologies, right? You know, internet came out of DARPA. You know, computers came out of DARPA. You know, GPS came out of DARPA. Just the list is enormous. So this solid support from the government to startups is absolutely critical. So as a matter of fact, for the last 3 years, I've been writing many notes and articles for the government and in newspapers where I have always said that demand aggregation is essential to make the startup ecosystem successful in this country. We've only got supply side, we don't have the demand side. So you're 700% right, that demand piece needs to be created. And this is something that my foundation and some of us are working on to make it aware for the government that you must recognize innovation. You know, you can't put out a tender and say, if you have not sold 5,000 of these, we will not buy from you. That's nonsense. That needs to change. So government has to be the largest buyer for startups and Indian industry. Can you imagine? Biden has taken a decision last year that they will give out $600 billion worth of business only to American companies. That's the kind of step India has to take.
Good evening, sir. So very nice eye-opening speech. I want to ask one thing, sir. In your career or in HCL experience, what was your biggest setback and how overcome from that setback? I want to know your experience, sir. Thank you, sir.
Well, actually, one of our biggest setbacks was that in year 1988-89, we decided to go to America to make computers. And it was based on a recommendation of a very large company called McKinsey. We were the largest computer company in India. They came to us and said, we want you to be our first customer. So we said, fine, but we can't afford you. They said, no, we'll do it everything free for you. They said, pro bono. So they wrote this great paper. They looked at our all range of our products that we were making, and they created this paper which said, this is your entry strategy for America. So they said, the kind of products that you're making in India, designing in India, multiprocessor, fine-grained Unix products are not available anywhere in the world. So we were quite shocked. We said, my God, we are probably pioneers. They said, no, you are definitely pioneers. If you go and make these products in America, you'll be very successful. So here we are. We borrow money from ICICI, $5 million. We went to Silicon Valley. We set up a factory there to make computers. This is like saying coal to Newcastle, right? So we did that. And as we did that, we got a lot of orders. We got business. We got a huge deal from somebody. And then suddenly we realized that we didn't have one particular certification that was required for hardware in America, which was for the power supply. And number two, there was a huge order that we got. That company got bought over by somebody else. So that whole order got lost. But we still had business. But because of this certification issue, we could not do anything. So great failure, $5 million down the drain. We could ill afford it. So we pivoted. What did we do? We quickly realized that we had great engineering capability. We could design computers, we could design chips, we could do a whole bunch of scientific engineering work for companies. So we started planting our people into R&D of various companies, and we sort of moved towards software. So it was a recovery from a great loss, but you know, every stumble makes you understand better. You know, people, all of you know that UPI is the world's largest, right? It's the biggest thing that we've created in the country. It's a product that we created. It went through 6 cycles of failure before it became successful. So these things are part of life.
हेलो सर, माय नेम इज सुमित. मेरा एक क्वेश्चन था कि इंडिया अपने आप को JNI में कैसे अलग स्टैंड आउट कर सकता है. लाइक हम जो भी अपने स्टार्टअप्स है वो ऑन द टॉप ऑफ ChatGPT ना बनाए, उसके जो भी LLM मॉडल है हम खुद के अपने खुद के LLM मॉडल्स बनाए, और किसी और कंट्री के ऊपर डिपेंड ना होके हम खुद के यहाँ पे स्टार्टअप्स बनाए, LLM मॉडल्स बनाए, जिससे हम अदर कंट्रीज पे डिपेंड ना रहे. थैंक यू.
देखिए आप, मैं एक इसमें बहुत क्रिटिकल हूँ इस इशू पे. वी गेट कैरिड अवे विद द बज ऑफ द ईयर, एंड द बज ऑफ द ईयर इज JNI. डोंट गेट कैरिड अवे प्लीज, बिकॉज LLMs आर स्टिल डेवलपिंग एंड दे आर नॉट एक्यूरेट एट ऑल. As a matter of fact, search engines are more accurate than LLMs today. A lot of times, LLMs will give you answers which are totally ridiculous because they don't have all the data. So I think it's a question of, since that's the, big thing about this season, JNI is big thing about this season, don't get carried away with it. I think what I told you earlier, look at how do we create products out of India. If we can create software products out of India, that's the direction to take. You look at Zoho. Have you heard of Zoho? How big is that company? That's right. It's a product company. HCL started looking at products 7 years ago. Today, we are India's largest software product company. Very few people know that. We are 18th largest in the world. We need to be in products, as I said. Don't get into this thinking of services alone. Okay? So, LLMs is the name of the game today. That not necessary that that's where we should be. We need to look at the huge opportunities that sit around all of us. You know, the electronics opportunity, which I am part of. Okay? We created the first... pretty much one of the first electronics companies in the country. You know what is the size of the electronics opportunity by 2047? $4 trillion. That's our opportunity. Electronics and hardware is going to be much bigger than software services. Already, electronics is 200 billion, software services 250 billion. Electronics and hardware have caught up with software. And I think the great opportunity in India and the world for us is to design products in India. There is a requirement for us to create the next NVIDIA out of India. That's what where should we should go. Okay?
Sir, I'll just take a quick question because I think we are all running out of time, and I have a fundamental point to make when you spoke that we need to be a very product-centric ecosystem here. But a large part of India is rural-based, and rural economy requires an approach of change management rather than commoditizing with things. Especially, I'm coming from agriculture and irrigation technology solutions. If you go with a product to a rural ecosystem, neither the trust nor a complete sustainable implementation happens, and that's one of the challenges that a startup of the agri-tech domain are facing, that how do they really make a sustainable market space in that area. So my reading of the system is that there has to be a mixture of a service component, especially to do the demand aggregation like what was brought out, because unless you have a change management or a structure kind of thing created, at least in the rural landscape, you will not be able to get the products there in a sustainable way. And so I feel largely we are a rural economy. We have a large amount of agrarian and, you know, rural ecosystem to service. I feel that the aggregation of the demand can happen through the service component of it, and that the product can definitely bring in that change or sustainable change that we're looking for.
See, nobody is saying give up services. Stay with the services. And but if you start to look at the opportunity is in value addition. See, services don't add value. So if you look at service, software services business, we used to have 50% gross margins earlier. What's your margin today? 20-odd%? Why? Because the world has caught up with you. Our costs in India are very, very high. As a result of that, our margins are completely squeezed as far as services are concerned. But when you make a $1,000 Apple, what do we do in India with Apple? We make such a big deal about getting Apple to make in India. What do we do? Out of the $1,000 Apple, we do $30. That's all we do. But what have we done to Apple in India? We've helped them create a 70,000 crore company. Is that the right way to do things? Because all we are doing is screwdriver technology. We're not adding any value. So that's really what I believe. Rural or not, urban, rural is all going to get mixed up very, very soon. Lots of rural pieces are becoming urban now. And we need to then create products for those people. The aspiration of a rural person is 100% the same as an urban person. When we did some research in rural areas, and we asked them, which mobile phone would you like to buy? The answer was Apple. It wasn't Micromax. So, you know, things are changing. The demands are changing. The things that were yesterday. You see, we cannot remain an agriculture country. We have to move into manufacturing. We have too much dependence on agriculture. There's too much dependence on... See, you talk about government buying. The whole... whole damn agriculture depends on government buying. What is this agitation all about, MSP? It's absolute nonsense. The whole of Punjab is, the grounds have been destroyed by just having one wheat and one rice. They've destroyed everything and they still want prices from the government. I don't understand this. They're so dependent, they get free bijli, free pani, no income tax and MSP. I mean, why? This whole agriculture economy of this country is an absolute disaster. We needed it when we needed food. We were importing food, that kachra wala food from PL 480 from US. Ganda sa rice we used to eat. All that is history. We have now become very large in making food. We are very large in making grains. All that has happened. But we now need to move differently. We need to go away to being a very... We are a very large country. If we don't manufacture things, we are not going to be successful. Look, China... America has suddenly realized they'd lost 20 years of manufacturing. All manufacturing went out of America. In the last 3 to 4 years, they're all working on getting that manufacturing back. Just imagine what is the condition of America today in semiconductors. As they say, one of the guys in America from the Senate said, the next wars will be fought with semiconductors. Okay? Tomorrow, if China takes over Taiwan, 60% of the world's semiconductors are gone. That's why America is desperately creating semiconductor plants. They know they've lost out very bad. So, you know, this whole movement from agriculture to manufacturing to products is the right way to go. This is my view. You may have your own view. Sorry. Yeah.
Thank you.
Who knows? The next CEO has to take the decision. I took my eyes off the business many years ago. I am only a shareholder now. I don't run the business, so I just watch from the outside, and I'm very happy with the share price today.
Thank you, Ajay sir, for such an enlightening session. And we would definitely remember the China story where you booked two flights and two hotels, you know, during the deal. And also telling us that the importance of quantum startups. That I think we at SIIC would seriously look at this startups who are working quantum, and we would definitely require support in developing next generation startups. And also thank you for letting us know that we should be next startup capital in the world, and next product capital as well. And you drove the point very strongly that the product market is something that it's, which is going to grow very much in next one or two decades. So I am truly inspired listening to you, and I want to read your book from today evening itself. And I am sure that all the audience here is looking forward to read your books. So for all of you, the Ajay sir's books are there outside, so you can have a look at them and you can buy them. I strongly recommend, I think all of you who are listening to Ajay sir's journey, I think it's all written so beautifully in the book. So I would request all of you to have a look at the book. Right. And yes. So we'll also be having a signing ceremony as well outside. So now we'll go moving forward with the ceremony. So I request Techriti team, Sneha, to give a memento to Ajay sir. Thank you so much, Techriti team, Sneha. I'm sure that you would support sir in promoting his book. Yes, thank you. So now I would request our beloved Professor Amitabha Bandopadhyay, Co-PIC, SIIC IIT Kanpur, to please come on the stage and give a gift to our dear Ajay sir. A big round of applause, please.
You know, you heard Ajay. I have been on 2-hour long Zoom call on every day from around March 27th till July 27th in 2020. I'll tell you one aspect of Ajay that may not have come through. He is a leader because of the quality. So in that team, there were young members like Ajay Chaudhary and very young members like Aditi, Tushar. And we'll be discussing about product features, how to get things done, etc. If a counter narrative comes from one of these very young members, Ajay would happily say, your idea is better, we'll go for that. So that's why he is inspiring. There's really a pleasure to have you here, Ajay, and to give you this gift.
Thank you so much, Amitabha sir. And I think for any startup founder, this friendship between our Ajay sir and Amitabha sir is a great example for you all, because in your journey, in your startup journey, it's very important to have lifelong relationships which you build in the journey, because that's what makes your startup. So now we'll have a book signing ceremony. So our Ajay sir, there are 5 books there. I would request Ajay sir to sign those 5 books. I would request everyone to please be seated for just 2 minutes, please. We'll conclude the session in just 2 minutes. Thank you. And whoever wants to buy the book, please, you can go outside near the door. There you can buy the books. There even we'll have that signing of those books also. So whoever buys the book, you can come to this backstage. There we'll have even signing of the books. So we will conclude this particular session in 2 minutes. Please be seated. Thank you. Everyone who's buying the book can just wait behind the stage. Our coordinator will come there and he will usher you into the signing of the books. Yeah. So we thank Ajay sir so much, and thank you all for being a great audience. So thank you, Ajay sir, and thank you all. Have a good evening. Thank you so much.